So where in the world can you find growth? Will the U.S. remain the quality market of choice? Our guests are uniquely qualified to respond. Our first guest, now a private investor, was the head of equities for Oppenheimer Funds. Bill Wilby is perhaps best known as the longtime award-winning manager of the Oppenheimer Global Fund, which was rated the number one global equity fund for the 12 years he managed the portfolio. And our second guest is another global equity specialist. He is Michael Hartnett. He is chief global emerging markets equity strategist at Merrill Lynch. He is an international economist with experience in both the developed and developing world. And finally, if you're looking for a safe harbor for your portfolio, Treasury bond expert Robert Kessler is your man. Robert and his firm, Kessler Investment Advisors, run portfolios for institutional investors and governments all over the world. Welcome to all of you. Great to have you here. Of all the global trends that I mentioned in my opening remarks, and there are a lot of them, which one do you think is the most significant?
I think inflation, broadly speaking, is perhaps the most important issue we face as investors right now, because inflation has a major impact on the outlook for all sorts of asset classes and which ones perform and which ones don't and whether any of them perform.
So why inflation? And you know, as you know, the Fed, looking at core inflation at any rate, thinks that inflation is not a big problem.
Well, I think, you know, looking at core inflation is like looking at the wrong indicators. I mean, you know, it's very interesting when you hear Federal Reserve officials saying that the Fed can't do anything about oil prices, that they have no impact on oil prices. I think what we're seeing in the commodity markets is a direct result of Federal Reserve policy.
And it's a direct result of Federal Reserve policy specifically because the dollar's declining, right?
Specifically because the dollar's declining, and the dollar reflects monetary policy.
So I think
inflation has a huge impact on the investment outlook, and the dollar, I believe, is key to the longer-term inflation outlook. You can't look at the dollar in terms of its short-term impact on inflation, but the longer-term impact inflation. If investors can't trust in the value of money going forward, it's a sad state of affairs. And I think that's the kind of crossroads we're at in the investment community right now. As we've had 25 years of a bull market in both financial assets and the financial industry because we had a Federal Reserve that basically was very vigilant and willing to incur short-term pain in order to maintain price stability. And what we have now, I think that thesis is really in question right now for the first time, and therefore the 25 years of a bull market in financial assets and the bull market in the financial industry is very much at risk.
Okay. Bill's just talked about a lot of things, Michael. Sure. And so, you know, my original question is, what do you think is the most significant development going on right now in the world? And the impact of the declining dollar certainly has had a big impact in the emerging markets.
Yeah, very much. And also the bull market in commodities has been great news for emerging markets. I mean, I think we're a little, you know, behind the U.S. in all this. I think, you know, you look at Brazil's investment upgrade this week. I mean, that is a direct result of Brazil doing what the U.S. did 25 years ago. I mean, if you go back to 1982, the S&P is at 100. It trades at 5 times earnings. Interest rates are 15%. Inflation's 15%. And Volcker's success and the American success at bringing inflation down over the past 25 years is exactly what Bill's talking about, and that engendered this multi-year bull market in many, many assets. In a place like Brazil, that's just beginning. And, you know, it's certainly our belief that excess returns from somewhere like Brazil will continue so long as they can persuade the rest of the world that they can keep that genie, that inflation, you know, genie in the lamp, because historically they've done a very bad job of that. So I think it's timing-wise we're in a different chronology in emerging markets. But obviously how the dollar pans out, commodities pan out, you know, is obviously, you know, big news so far as my asset, emerging market equities, are concerned.
So if Bill's right, and in fact, I mean, the dollar is at risk,
mm-hmm.
Then that actually can be a positive, and it has been
sure.
a positive
yeah.
for the emerging markets, right?
Usually.
So in a way, instead of the decoupling argument, it can be the fact that they are so affected by that.
Well, decoupling, I mean, there's a lot
positive.
Of things going on here, but
right,
I mean, I certainly think if the dollar is in a bear market and that continues, and if the commodities are in a bull market and that continues, then emerging markets will continue to be in a bull market, all other things being equal. Decoupling is a different story. There is a lot of evidence in emerging markets that they have in a macroeconomic sense, decoupled from the US, if decoupling basically means that we can withstand better than we have in the past a US recession. And a lot of trade statistics, inflation statistics suggest that that is the case. The dirty little secret, perhaps, is that places like Brazil, India, they were never that coupled with the US to begin with.
Robert, I know you've got you're thinking about a lot. You want to respond to what? Where do you want to start as far as Bill's argument and what Michael's talking about as well?
This is such an interesting period of time for me because being in the credit markets, the question really is how much unregulated credit has gone into this market? And what has happened, at least in the last 10, 15 years that I can see, is we've created so much excess credit, which we will never see again. We will never have the period of time that we looked at for the last 7 or 8 years because no bank can afford to do it anymore. So if you begin to shut that down, then you begin to shut down all of these abilities to grow. And so though I'm not against, I like the idea of decoupling. I mean, it's all very, very intriguing to think that this can happen. But without credit, without incredible liquidity, then the market begins to shut down. And that's what we're seeing. So we have this kind of slow train wreck that we're looking at and this kind of emerging series of events that's taking place, and we're beginning to see it unfold. Thank you. The banks go, the credit goes, and then the consumer begins to slow down.